We're going to get started with the introductions. All right. So what typically happens is a lot of people will join in the next 1 to 2 minutes. But I'll get started now, and then we can get started right away. And then, as we discussed, I'll give you a heads up when it's like 7:30, 7:35. All right, so welcome everyone to Grand Rounds this morning. Thank you for joining us for this virtual Grand Rounds. I have the pleasure of introducing one of our residency alumni who has graciously accepted to speak with us this morning. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce her. Some of you may already know her. Dr. Tina Doshi earned her undergraduate degrees from the University of Virginia and her MD from Duke University. She then completed residency training in anesthesiology here at Washington University, where she also served as chief resident, doing the job I'm doing right now. So we are closing the circle today. After residency, she pursued fellowship training in pain medicine and an MHS in clinical investigation from Johns Hopkins and stayed on as faculty. She's currently an assistant professor in the Department of Anesthesiology and Critical Care and the Department of Neurological Surgery at Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine. Dr. Doshi is also an accomplished NIH-funded physician scientist, focusing on chronic pain, clinical trials, precision medicine, diversity, and inclusion. Today, she will be discussing the gender gap and racism in pain management. So please join me in welcoming back Dr. Doshi to the Washington University Department of Anesthesiology Grand Rounds.
All right, great. Thank you so much. It's so wonderful to be here and so nice to see all these familiar names and faces. And I have to admit, I was saying this before we started, but I never thought that I would be, as a resident, I never thought that I'd be coming back for to speak at Grand Rounds, and especially not for this topic. And so it's really nice. And I'm so honored to be back and speaking to you guys about this. So we're going to be talking about the gender gap and racism in pain medicine. And before I begin, disclosures, current and past research funding, nothing that is going to be related to this talk. But what I want to do is talk about sex and gender and racial inequities in pain research, pain treatment, and among pain clinicians, to understand the benefits of diversity among pain researchers and clinicians as steps for developing effective personalized pain care, and to identify strategies to address inequities in pain medicine and improve diversity. And so, like I said, this was not a topic that I ever thought I would become interested in or develop an expertise in, but the more I think about it, the more it seems really obvious, because I've always been a data-driven person. And so when I looked at this this topic and this issue, I understood that in order to be a good doctor and in order to be a good scientist, I really needed to know about the individual, know and recognize that individuals of different sexes, genders, and races have really markedly different pain experiences. And this often occurs with really profoundly negative healthcare consequences. And also importantly, that diversity and inclusion within the pain workforce is critical to addressing those inequities. So I'll start with my main area of expertise, which is the gender gap in pain medicine, but we'll then shift to racism. But when I talk about the gender gap, I will use the terms sex and gender. Sex referring to male-female designation of humans and other living things based on reproductive function, so in other words, biology. And gender refers to the human expression of social and cultural attributes that are associated with a particular sex, like in other words, like psychology and sociology. So I don't intend to conflate the two terms of sex and gender, but I will often use them interchangeably in this talk because they're studied that way in medicine and medical research. So how is pain different for women? Well, it's a combination of multiple factors, biological factors, psychological factors, and sociological factors. And they manifest themselves as differences in all the aspects of the pain experience, whether that's neurophysiology, what we know about the nociception pathway, right? Transduction, transmission, perception, modulation. It occurs in pain research. And then we have to consider sex as a biological variable. And we have to think critically about how we conduct and interpret clinical trials. And it also crops up in pain treatment and how patients are treated differently depending on whether they're men or whether they're women. And it has a lot to do with stigma and this idea of implicit bias, which I'll talk a little bit more about when I discuss racism. But those are factors that play into this really markedly different pain experience for women compared to men. So sex differences in pain include all of these aspects of pain physiology. There are a lot of biological, clearly documented, clearly studied biological differences in pain. And they can begin with genetic differences where, here, let me use my little laser pointer here. Genetic differences where the expression and response to different polymorphisms of genes like the opioid receptor or the estrogen receptor can manifest themselves as differences in clinical or experimental pain models, in differences in gene expression profiles in various pain conditions, osteoarthritis, temporomandibular disorder being some great examples. And then you have this idea of neuroimmune modulation. We are increasingly appreciating the role of the immune system in the development and chronification of pain. And we also know that innate and adaptive immune responses are different in females compared to males, and that that autoimmune disorders are more common in females. And so these two observations coupled together led to evidence that neuroimmune modulation of pain is different in females compared to males. So cortical processing is another aspect where there are sex and gender differences. Neuroimaging studies have found that there are differentially active areas of the brain corresponding to differences in pain perception and affective responses, things like pain unpleasantness. And finally, the endogenous opioid system seems to operate differently in women compared to men. They work and respond to the different opioid receptors, work and respond to opioids differently with differential activation of the different opioid receptor subtypes, leading to differences in pain responses. Opioids are more likely to affect nociception in males compared to females, and they are also more likely to trigger responses related to opioid-induced hyperalgesia in females compared to males. And so all along these different aspects of pain, you can have sex hormones that influence all of these various factors. And these sex hormones we know change over the course of the lifespan, whether it's for things like puberty, pregnancy, menopause, over the course of the menstrual cycle, or with the use of hormonal contraceptives or hormone replacement therapy. Gender influences can also, there can also be psychosocial factors for gender influences in pain. So we know that gender influences how people cope with pain, their own sense of self-efficacy. And we know that, of course, self-efficacy, things like pain catastrophizing, things like pain coping, all modulate the pain experience. There are also gender role expectations within our society certain behaviors and activities being more feminine or more masculine. And those gender role expectations can also cause pain to manifest themselves differently and be expressed differently in women compared to men. And lastly, in terms of psychosocial factors, we know that environmental stressors on women are different, especially factors like sexual and physical abuse, where women are far more likely to be victims of that type of trauma. And those things are more likely to increase the prevalence and severity of chronic pain. Compounding all of those differences, medicine has a really long history of viewing women in pain differently, starting with this idea from Hippocrates that the uterus is the root of hysteria, and the fact that women who don't have children have empty wombs. And so the wandering womb is this source of profound psychological dysfunction. This idea of pain as punishment, you know, Eve taking the apple from the tree of knowledge, and childbirth is the punishment. Pain in childbirth is the punishment for that sin. And then during the Industrial Revolution, we have this idea that, you know, if you are more affluent and not needing to work, that you have the luxury of being frail as a woman. You are more entitled. You are more privileged, and so it's fashionable to be perceived as weak, to express pain, to be viewed as someone who is vulnerable. And this continues even into modern times. We have this perception within the pain community of women in pain as being particularly difficult patients. And I will admit that as a trainee, I often had this perception as well. And so all of these things come together to, again, make women experience pain differently. We know that they have a higher prevalence of common pain disorders, things like fibromyalgia, my personal clinical interest, craniofacial pain, so migraines, tension type headaches, temporomandibular disorder, but also irritable bowel syndrome, pelvic pain, common things like musculoskeletal pain, osteoarthritis, and neuropathic pain. All of these have a higher prevalence in women of women compared to men with these pain conditions. And within these same pain disorders, there is a greater pain severity, up to about 20% increased pain on average for women compared to men with the same pain diagnoses. And this is across almost all pain diagnoses. So different studies quoted somewhere 72 to 95% of the population, the pain population studied. In these different populations, women have worse pain patient-reported outcome measures, things like pain intensity, decreased quality of life, increased pain interference, higher incidence of comorbid depression and anxiety. And there is some mixed evidence of increased acute postoperative pain. So not just chronic pain disorders, but also acute postoperative pain or acute pain after other types of injury. And it turns out that women are not studied all that differently in pain research, and that's to their detriment. When we look at the preclinical research, we find that earlier on in pain research, there's a predominance of male animals. Fortunately, the NIH has made it a priority to include both male and female subjects in preclinical research, and now also in clinical research. But those studies that we're doing now are still, even though they may be using both sexes, often based on observations from older studies that used only the male subjects. And so perhaps we're not going back far enough, perhaps we're not starting back at the beginning. And so we may not be capturing truly all of the differences that women have when it comes to pain. We also find that within clinical research, really few analyses are stratified by sex, and even fewer studies perform sex matching in the analyses. And this, you look at the publications, and this is where a lot of the problem is. Journals don't emphasize these differences, and editors and peer reviewers don't ask for this data. They don't even think to ask for this data. And so it becomes something that we don't recognize as being a problem. And how that translates is that then we have pain, women's pain being treated differently. The treatment options that we have for women don't work the same way. And then when we apply our treatment options to women, it's done differently compared to men. There's a huge body of research looking at how women's pain is treated differently. They are more likely to be rated as exaggerating. They're less likely to be seen as trustworthy in reporting of their pain. They're less likely to receive analgesics for the same pain condition. Although this is based off of a few older studies from about like 10 or 15 years ago, and there are a couple of newer studies to suggest that this gap may be narrowing, especially when we consider the emphasis on decreasing opioid use in both the acute and chronic settings. We also know that women are less likely to undergo surgery and more likely to wait for surgery for the same underlying pathology, surgical pathology. And this is mostly coming from the joint surgery literature, including things like hip fracture surgery, shoulder surgery, joint replacement surgery. And within those types of surgeries, women are less likely to receive evidence-based care, and they're less likely to have positive outcomes from their care, partially because they may be less likely to undergo surgery or be recommended for surgery, and partially because they may be waiting longer and having worse pathology before they even get to the point of getting surgery. So to summarize, really, the pain experience, like I said, is really different from the pain experience for men. So we have these fundamental differences in biological, psychological, and sociological factors that lead to these differences. And it's exacerbated by how the medical and scientific community treats women's pain, which leads to overall poor pain treatment outcomes. So by contrast, the real driving force when we talk about racism in pain medicine, we talk about racial inequities. The real driving force is that those inequities have much less to do with the intrinsic characteristics of the individuals within those races, and much more to do with how the individuals of racial minorities are treated within our society by our communities, and by healthcare professionals. But despite that, we see similar negative health consequences for racial minorities as we do for women. And there's a historical perspective for this, right? And I'm going to emphasize, I know some of you may be Canadian, but I'm going to emphasize the American historical perspective because this is our current context. But it goes back even farther than the 1800s, but the current really egregious ideas about, or the egregious examples of racial discrimination in healthcare within pain medicine. One of the best known examples is J. Marion Sims, who is known as the father of gynecology. And what makes him really controversial is that he performed surgeries, often without informed consent, often without anesthesia, on enslaved women. And a lot of the scientific literature and the evidence that he used to report and popularize his surgical techniques and his medical ideas were done without the on subjects who were not able to consent, who were in positions of vulnerability, and who were really subjected to unethical treatment. This continues into the 20th century with many multiple state-sponsored forced sterilization programs of racial and ethnic minorities, especially in institutionalized settings like prisons and mental institutions. And these ideas were used to promote eugenics. And they were actually what inspired Adolf Hitler to develop his own eugenics programs. Everybody knows, anybody who's ever taken an IRB course knows about the Tuskegee syphilis study, where Black men were denied known effective treatments for syphilis so that researchers could study the natural course of the disease, well into the 1970s, well after penicillin, which is known to be an effective treatment for syphilis, was made available. even as recently as the 1990s in my own backyard at Johns Hopkins, the Baltimore lead paint study. Lead was identified as being elevated and associated with worse healthcare outcomes for kids, particularly in these areas that had high African-American populations. These parents were never notified. These kids were never treated. And this didn't come out until years after the years into the study. And of course, we're all familiar with the Flint water crisis. And so it's within this context that racial minorities, particularly Blacks, African-Americans, have developed this distrust of the medical community. And it's really a result of this discrimination, an unfair or unequal treatment of an individual or group based on specific characteristics. So those were really egregious examples, but there are many instances, smaller instances of discrimination that occur on a daily basis within healthcare and within pain medicine. And these are not always intentional. This unfair, unequal treatment, it's not always on purpose, but it's often rooted in unconscious, sometimes called implicit bias. And these are social stereotypes that are formed outside our conscious awareness and personal control. So everyone, you, me, every single person on this call possesses some unconscious biases. And it's only natural. It's human to categorize other people based on distinctive characteristics, and things like race and gender are very obvious ways to group people together. However, that manifests itself in terms of unequal treatment for racial minorities in healthcare. And so lots of studies showing that medical professionals tend to report preferences for interacting with white patients over Black patients. They rate white patients as more medically cooperative and more adherent to treatment programs than Black patients. And even as recently, this study is crazy because it was only published about 5 years ago, but medical trainees still falsely believe that Black patients have a higher pain tolerance than whites. And I found this really astonishing. And so we see this. We also see that clinician visits in general with Black patients tend to be less patient-centered and scored lower for interpersonal care. And so when we look at Black patients in pain, we know that they're prescribed fewer opioids than matched white patients for the same acute pain complaints. They are in cohort studies from the VA, Medicaid, and other administrative databases. They are persistently under-prescribed analgesics for the same pain conditions. They less frequently receive regional anesthesia for joint replacement surgery. And this is a really big deal, right? Because we are concerned about optimizing perioperative care for patients, but we're not giving them the best possible care. Because they're Black? Maybe. And we also know that less frequently Black patients receive spinal cord stimulation implants for post-laminectomy syndrome. And this is one of the most common indications for spinal cord stimulation. So this is not just a matter of holding misconceptions and kind of offending people. There is a wealth of literature that describes how perceived discrimination can cause measurable physiologic stress, which can in turn have serious health consequences. So not only do we have negative healthcare or poor healthcare treatment for racial minorities, but we also compound this problem with the discrimination that they experience causing measurable biological changes. And so there's evidence for this idea that racial discrimination is a type of stressful life experience that can negatively affect health. It's related to participation in unhealthy and non-participation in healthy behaviors. And to understand this, I want to introduce this idea of allostatic load and weathering. And so this is an idea that was popularized by researchers Bruce McEwen and Elliot Steller of allostatic load or physiologic consequences of chronic exposure to stress, wear and tear, and that these things like these environmental factors can cause biological changes. And so Arlene Geronimus expanded on this idea with several landmark studies that identified social adversity and marginalization of racial and ethnic minorities as one type of chronic stressor that leads to this wear and tear and results in negative health effects. And in fact, there are many studies that look at discrimination and physiological markers of aging, things like telomere length, telomerase activity, and the risk of aging-related diseases, things like coronary artery disease, osteoarthritis, cognitive decline, osteoporosis, and many of those, of course, are associated with chronic pain. So we also find that discrimination literally hurts. And so this study looked at perceived discrimination, daily discrimination, or lifetime discrimination, and a person's likelihood of developing chronic pain conditions. So we see that the more someone reports perceived discrimination, the more likely they are to have chronic pain conditions. So given this really well-known bi-directional relationship between stress and chronic pain, what I would argue is that a failure to consider and address discrimination, particularly racial discrimination, is analogous to failing to assess and treat stressors like depression or anxiety in a chronic pain patient. And this is not just for patients. This is for us too, as healthcare professionals, because we need to think of repeated exposure to discrimination as a stressor that leads to, that's a threat to workplace safety and a risk factor for burnout. We know that bullying, mistreatment, discrimination is far more likely to be reported by women and those of racial and ethnic minorities, and that individuals who report bullying, mistreatment, and discrimination are far more likely to have increased levels of stress, increased likelihood of burnout, higher attrition rates, and most troubling, increased thoughts of suicide. And so discrimination, whether it's sex, racial, or some other form, has negative consequences to our own health and well-being. And it adversely affects our ability to provide the best possible care for patients. So with all those ideas in mind, I want to present the central idea of this talk, which is that the key to addressing these observed inequities in pain medicine experienced by minorities and in women, the key to addressing those inequities is to promote diversity, inclusion, and equity in the pain medicine workforce. And so to introduce that idea, I'll give you some definitions. So when you talk about diversity, we mean having many different forms, types, or ideas, showing variety, groups comprised of people of different backgrounds. And this can be many different traits. And the NIH has a really nice slide deck for the Workforce Diversity Toolkit. I encourage you to check it out if you're interested. But it really identifies a lot of the, or highlights that there are many types of diversity. And that includes not just things like race, gender, sexual orientation, culture, but also things like thinking styles and language and skills and perspective. And each type of diversity here offers value in different ways. And so in order to take advantage of the benefits offered by each individual, all the different aspects of diversity that we can offer, we have to practice inclusion. And that's the act of including, the state of being included. And really it's the recognition and acceptance of the strengths that are contributed by each and every employee or individual within an organization. And the promotion of equity is what allows inclusion to happen. So equity is the fair treatment, access, opportunity, and advancement for all people, and striving, and not just that, but striving to identify and eliminate the barriers that prevent the full participation of some of those groups. And often people will try to use equity and equality interchangeably, but they're actually very different things. And so I love this, this cartoon from the Interaction Institute for Social Change. And it really demonstrates that not everybody starts with the same advantages and opportunities. And so you can't just give everyone the same thing as we would for equality and expect a better outcome. To be able to reap the benefits of everyone's perspective, to be able to maximize on the benefits of diversity, we have to acknowledge that some individuals are going to need more help than others. So with that in mind, let's take a look at how diverse pain medicine is. And this started when I was an early junior faculty, and a good friend of mine, Mark Bickett, was the program director at Johns Hopkins at the time. And one day we were talking, and in passing, he noted, you know, I have been looking through the fellowship interview applications, and I noticed that we don't have that many women applicants. Like, is this a thing? Like, are there not a lot of women who are interested in pain medicine? Like, what can we do to promote or to encourage more women to apply? And do you want to take a look at this? And I was like, any good junior faculty member, I said yes to everything, and down the rabbit hole I went, right? And so that's what led to this publication, which was in Wrapham in 2018. But what I found was really kind of disturbing. So at that time, and these numbers haven't really changed all that much since then, women were about 50% of medical students. And in fact, women now account for greater than 50% of medical school applicants and matriculants. They're about a third of anesthesiology residents. That number hasn't really changed. They are about a quarter, a little less than a quarter, of pain medicine fellows, and 18% of pain physicians. So at every step of the way, after medical school, women become underrepresented, and it gets worse as you go down the pain medicine pipeline. And like I said, these numbers haven't really changed. Right now, women comprise approximately 35% of active physicians and only 19% of practicing pain medicine physicians. When we look at the gender distribution of trainees within pain medicine and the pain medicine pipeline, we find that these numbers have been static over the course of many years. I always get asked when I put up this slide, what is it now? Well, I'll tell you, it's not all that different, with a few really notable exceptions. One is that the overall gender distribution of trainees is becoming closer to 50%, with 46% female, with the most recent data from the ACGME. PM&R, and anesthesiology, which are the main feeder specialties for pain medicine fellowship, have been largely unchanged, around a third over that same time period. Pain medicine also hovering around 20 to 25%. Fortunately, it's 26% now, so maybe that is an upward trend. But over that same period of time, general surgery, which is historically considered a specialty dominated by men, has slowly been creeping upward. And so now general surgery is almost close to the overall gender distribution of trainees. So what is it that we're doing wrong within pain medicine and the pain medicine pipeline that we can do better? So this is true not just for gender representation within pain medicine, but also for racial representation in the pain pipeline. This research comes from Charles Ondakor, who was actually a PM&R resident at Hopkins, and Peju Adekoya and Waire Uhuru also were at Hopkins. They did the study looking at racial and gender distribution of trainees, medical director, program directors, and pain fellows within the United States in 2018. And what we find, again, is that pain fellows are of racial and ethnic minorities are grossly underrepresented within the pain medicine community. Pain fellowship program directors of racial and ethnic minorities are underrepresented. Residents are underrepresented. And this is worse than what we see for medical school matriculants. So this is a pretty grim set of statistics, but it really emphasizes how dire the situation is for women and minorities in medicine. So Black physicians make, on average, about $65,000 per year less than their white counterparts. And female physicians make, of both races, make less than their white male, or than their male counterparts. And this is even after adjustment for age, experience, hours worked, practice type, and specialty. Hitting a little bit closer to home, we know that female anesthesiologists make 29% less than their male colleagues, even after adjusting for experience, employer type, and work hours. Admittedly, this 29%, when you adjust, becomes a little bit less, but it still is persistent even after you do that adjustment. Female pain physicians receive 30 to 45% less in total Medicare payments compared to their male colleagues with comparable years in practice. Women and minorities are underrepresented in leadership and professional recognition in anesthesiology. No significant proportion, no significant change in the proportion of women who have received the Distinguished Service Award at the ASA. No significant difference in leadership of the ASA. And we also know that women physicians are less likely to be promoted to associate professor or full professor over, or to be appointed as a department chair over a 35-year period. And this gap has not narrowed over time. Over 35 years, this gap has not narrowed. So there are lots of thoughts, theories about why diversity has really just not occurred, why there's inequity and lack of inclusion, not just within medicine in general, but pain medicine in specific, but pain medicine specifically. And some people will point to historical trends and say, you know, it's only been recently that women or minorities have increased their medical school applications, and it's just going to take some time to get to increased diversity. And I really don't think that's true, because hopefully what I've shown you within the past few slides is that these gaps have not narrowed. And yet at the same time, we see that, you know, medical students have been at least 40% female since the 1990s. So we've had 30 years, if not more, to narrow these gaps, but they still persist. And so other things we've looked at have been inequities in promotions, prestige, and pay, maybe causing people to become less interested, causing women or racial and ethnic minorities to become less interested in going into pain medicine. A need for mentorship and sponsorship has often been cited. And perhaps it may be reflective of specialty, institutional, or organizational cultures. And so to go along with that idea of that, we did a study a couple of years ago looking at the representation of women in pain medicine fellowships in the 2017 to 2018 academic year. And it really highlights this idea that you can't be what you can't see. And so female program director, having a female program director in a pain fellowship was associated, significantly associated with having increased likelihood of having female trainees. Male PDs was about the same. And having a female division chief or female division leader was significantly associated with having female faculty. So you can't be what you can't see. And this may be a reflection of specific institutional or organizational cultures that make it more acceptable or more appealing for women to be in that environment. And, you know, regardless of what the reasons are, you know, we made this point in our original editorial, Mark and I made this point, was that the sad truth is that pain medicine as a specialty has failed to prioritize and nurture the role of women in the profession. And this is less likely a reflection of overt discrimination, but more likely the product of inattention and complacency. And so this brings me to the point of why diversity isn't important. And so I'm going to give you a few different perspectives, a few diverse perspectives for why diversity is important. And so I'll start with a scientific perspective and the story of Scott Page. So Scott Page is a computational social scientist, and he, in the early aughts, he was teaching a computational problem solving class, some computational problem solving in a complex systems analysis class. And what he wanted to demonstrate to his students is that if you work really hard and you have the best to find the best possible solution to a problem and become the best performer, you will beat a team of random agents that don't have the best possible strategies every time. So you put together a whole bunch of high scorers, they're always going to outperform the random group of people in a complex problem-solving task. So the hypothesis, teams comprised of agents with the greatest individual ability will outperform teams of random or more diverse agents. So he had his students write this code, he had them run the simulations. And when he got the results, he was really confused and he was like, there's gotta be something wrong. So he ran the results again, did the analysis again, and he came up with the same results. And again, no matter how many times he ran this simulation, he came up with the same surprising results. And what he found is this, that the diverse group almost always outperforms the group of the best by a substantial margin. In other words, diversity trumps ability and diversity trumps homogeneity. So let that sink in for a moment. Diversity is better than ability alone, and diversity is better than homogeneity. And so why is that? Well, we really need to think about problems and problem solving as requiring not just one metric or one approach, but we need to think of problem solving as requiring a toolbox of skills. And so when you are looking for the highest performers along one metric, you're only looking at one specific thing, one specific number, or one specific score. And you're kind of discounting the potential contributions of people who score lower on that one metric. But if you look at people and people's abilities as a toolbox, drawing from different perspectives, heuristics, interpretations, and predictive models, we can understand why the more diverse team is going to outperform the more homogeneous, high-performing team. And we see this in action in many examples from the scientific literature. Group problem solving performance is related to a collective intelligence factor, which is related to average social sensitivity, in other words, inclusion, the distribution of conversational turn taking, in other words, equity, and the proportion of females within the group, in other words, diversity. And it is not related to average or maximal individual intelligence. Excuse me. We also know that gender heterogeneous authorship teams receive more citations. And if you use that as a surrogate for higher impact, better quality research. We find that, gender heterogeneous teams are doing better jobs. From the business perspective, we know that diversity is associated with improved financial performance, and a lack of diversity is associated with decreased profitability. So, the highest performers in terms of diversity have increase of 53% returns on equity, and the lowest performers in terms of diversity have a penalty of 29% decreased profitability. And this is true from in countries all around the world, different business sectors, and we see these results time and time again. Not only that, but diversity is associated with lower turnover, increased job satisfaction, greater sense of inclusion, and improved knowledge sharing. And all of these are important for enhancing worker and business productivity and innovation. From the healthcare perspective, we know that peer diversity enhances the medical student educational experience, and it actually increases the students' confidence on graduation in establishing rapport with patients from different backgrounds. We know that racial and ethnic minorities are more significantly more likely to serve minority and medically underserved communities. And we know that participants are more likely to have a patients are more likely to have a participatory patient-physician relationship, increased satisfaction, and improved adherence to medical device when their physician's life experience somehow more closely matches their own. So we've talked about the various benefits of diversity in the pain research and pain treatment workforce, and that's includes higher quality research, improved healthcare outcomes, better evidence-based medicine, stronger financial performance. But I want to give you one last perspective, and that's the philosophical perspective. So we need to think about our mission and why it is that you're in medicine and why you do what you do. And it's really illuminating to look at various mission statements or vision statements for departments and professional societies and institutions. And what we find here with all these organizations that are involved in pain treatment, the common themes are advancement, improvement, and promotion. These are all really dynamic things. And I submit to you that we can't carry out these missions without diversity, not just of gender, race and ethnicity, age, geography, cultural background, socioeconomic status, not just of those things. What we really need is diversity in those things, because it translates to diversity of perspective, diversity of experience, of skills, and of membership and leadership. So how do we do that? Well, I really like this editorial from ANA a couple of years ago. Kate Leslie, Harriet Hopp, wrote this along with a couple other folks, but they nicely summarized a 10-point plan to improve women, minorities, and leadership, or women and minorities within anesthesiology, collect the data, develop policy, make it visible, establish an informed and balanced recruitment advisory group within the organization, report on the data that you collect, build and use databases to continue to revisit that information, respond to resistance, support female minority office bearers, be family friendly, and take this pledge to commit to promoting women and minorities within anesthesiology. And I think the really most, one of the most important points from this is the importance of individual responsibility. And that comes in a quote. It says, "Whatever your gender or minority status, when thinking about standing for office, ask for the policy and the data and see whether this is an organization that takes diversity seriously. If it is not, then you have a choice. Reconsider your involvement or seek election and change the organization from within." I strongly recommend the latter. And so we've expanded a lot on these ideas to address racism in pain medicine, and particularly on the idea of our own personal responsibilities healthcare professionals and within the medical community to address inequities in care by examining our implicit biases individually and collectively. And we've given some advice about strategies to improve diversity within pain practices and within pain professional societies. So I'll finish with a case study in trying to promote diversity and inclusion in pain medicine. So this is Azra, 2017. At the time, it was 42 years old, 43 Gaston Labatt Award recipients, of which only two had been female. At the time, the most recent year in which a woman had received one of our most distinguished awards, the John J. Bonico Award, was 2002. And since then, six women had received the prize, the Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine. In the 42-year history of ASRA, there were only ever six women on the board of directors, and there was only, at the time, one female physician currently on the ASRA board. And so I noticed these things, and this was at a time when special interest groups were really starting to become popular within ASRA as a professional organization. And it was around that time that Mark Bickett had asked me to look at these issues of diversity within pain medicine. And I talked to my division chief, Steve Cohen, who was on the board of directors at ASRA at the time, and he referred me to Dan Warren, who was at Virginia Mason, but was the ASRA kind of chair of SIGS at the time. And these people were really instrumental for helping me develop the Women in Regional Anesthesia and Pain Medicine Special Interest Group. And I put their pictures up here because I want you to notice something. These are all white men, right? And so it is so important, right, to have great allies who are in positions of authority, who will support you and who understand the need for diversity and inclusion and will help pave the way. So we created the RAPM Special Interest Group, our mission to recruit and promote the contributions of women in our specialty. I had a great leadership team, Andrea Nickel, Sandy Kopp, Susie Moschler, Sandy Christensen, wonderful founding members. And we've done lots of things within ASRA as an organization, podcasts, newsletters, features in ASRA News, interactive panel discussions, networking events. It's routinely one of the most well-attended SIG meetings at every ASRA conference. We work with the meeting chairs to develop content, suggest speakers. We work with a membership committee to identify ASRA membership benefits that will recruit and support women. And out of 5,000 total members in ASRA Pain Medicine, 900 are members of our SIG. And not to take all the credit for all the wonderful things that have happened at ASRA over this time, because clearly there is a trend to increase female representation in ASRA. But we really are proud of the fact that we've been able to be a part of this kind of tide to improve diversity and inclusion within the organization. And one of the highlights is in 2019, our annual pain medicine meeting, we had no males. We had our first ever all-female panel, and it was not on a subject related to diversity and inclusion. It was on headache medicine. And that was the year that we announced 2020 as the year of women in ASRA. And since then, we've grown from having just one female board member to having three female physicians on the board, plus Angie Stengel, who's the executive director. I will tell you that all of these non-female physicians on the board have been incredibly supportive. We had the ASRA Trailblazer Award as part of the Year of Women in ASRA. Kaiser Enneking was a recent recipient of the Gaston Labatt Award. Both of our early stage investigator award recipients were women. Two out of five of the resident or fellows of the year have been women. And we've had lots of features within the ASRA newsletter, ASRA blog, and the ASRA website, highlighting issues of increasing diversity and promoting women in our specialty. So what did we get right there? Well, really, to foster diversity, equity, and inclusion, we need to make it a core value and not a checkbox. We integrated it into every aspect of the organization rather than just making an isolated office. We promoted diverse trainees and junior faculty, prioritizing topics of pain disparities in continuing education and conferences, includes thoughtful review of panel and speaker proposals, diverse community committees, and that includes the planning committees, awards, grants, and using ongoing review and revision of existing guidelines and policies. I'm gonna skip real quickly to the end. Just wanted to introduce another group though that I have been really proud to be a part of, promoting and respecting our women doctors, that really has leveraged social media, academic literature, and the enthusiasm of the medical community to affect culture change and improve gender equity. And so in summary, I hope that this talk has allowed you to view the gender gap and racism as modifiable risk factors of negative pain-related outcomes, as barriers to the ability of the physician workforce to address healthcare inequities, and as direct threats to the culture of safety that we hope to create within our healthcare organizations. And I also want you to recognize the promotion of diversity, equity, and inclusion as a lens to understand how personal characteristics and experiences shape our individual health. See diversity as an evidence-based strategy to improve healthcare outcomes, as a logical strategy to solve complex problems, as a key driver of innovation and promoting robust scientific inquiry, as a smart financial strategy, and as an ethical imperative vital to the practice of science and medicine. So with that, I think we have just a few minutes for questions. I thank you all so much for your time and for inviting me, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you so much for that great talk, Dr. Doshi. I think it really hits home for us here at the department. I'm going to open up for anyone to be able to unmute themselves to ask any questions or to put them in the chat, and I'll be happy to ask them for you. In the meantime, I'm going to get us started with a question relating to the NIH toolbox. I thought that was really interesting how you looked at all these different domains that exist in diversity. And I was curious to know if you know of any methods to quantify or to measure diversity across these domains so that you get a measure either for an individual or probably more likely for a group's diversity, not only in gender or in sex or in race, but across these domains, how diverse a group is.
Yeah, I mean, that's a great question. And it's hard, right? Because what you're really hoping for is like a little test, right, that everyone could take, but every individual is a diverse set of characteristics, right? So you have to really consciously identify those key components that are most important to you to achieve that diversity of perspective. And so, I mean, it's not really an answer to your question other than to say that, you know, if you want diversity, gender diversity, then you got to count and report gender and gender identification. If you want racial, you have to actually gather that data. And there are ways, you know, questionnaires, learning style profiles for, you know, how to try and gauge how people think. It turns out that research on learning styles is not all that great for improving outcomes, and it's better to focus on other personality traits that may be more likely to affect positive change. But I will say that you need to know what data you're looking for and then just get that data.
Okay, so it sounds like there's not like an overall diversity metric.
It's really— you can't get a diversity scorecard unless you're scoring for specifically like gender diversity or racial and ethnic diversity.
I see. I'll open up if anyone else wants to ask. I think we have time for one question. Okay, and that's, I do have one more then that I'd like to quickly get an answer to, and that's how you take all the, clearly this is something that you've explored a lot over the last few years, and I'm curious to know how you integrate this into your practice as a pain medicine physician. If you think about this on a daily basis, when you meet a patient, when you're recruiting staff for your clinic, et cetera.
Oh yeah, definitely. So I think I mentioned this earlier. I used to be one of those people who just like, I'm so frustrated by these female patients. Like this is really like, I just don't want to see them. I don't want to see like these pelvic pain patients and, you know, all that stuff. And so I had to recognize and come to terms with that bias and kind of acknowledge that, no, this is how they are expressing their suffering, their vulnerability, their pain experience. And, you know, I had to go back to my own mission, right? What's the reason why I'm in pain medicine? Why do I do what I do? And so that requires me to kind of overcome that bias, that kind of gut feeling of like, oh, like, I don't want to see this patient, to figure out ways that I really want to help them. And understand that people communicate their pain differently. They experience their pain differently. So to acknowledge that difference. And also the other part of your question about recruiting staff and trainees and faculty, this is something that's become really important to me as well as someone who interviews and scores applicants for the residency program, for the fellowship program. When I'm looking at these applications, I used to just like, you know, flip through like, what are their board scores? What are some keywords in their recommendations? But now doing this, I've become much more aware of how different experiences can influence things like board scores, can influence things like what is written in your letter as a recommendation. And so truly trying to get a better sense of the person rather than just what's, you know, what you can score or put in black and white.
Thanks for that answer. Yeah, I think that's something that we're trying to integrate as well, as now we're, you know, becoming more conscious of these importances and having a diverse workforce. So I think that we're going to take those lessons as well as we're looking at medical students and residents and fellows. So thank you. And I see that Dr. Palenka also put a question in the chat. It's 7:47, so I'm going to have to cut us off, but I'll be happy to let you guys chat offline. Thank you so much for coming and speaking with us today. Dr. Giroux, hello, welcome.
Hi, Rob.
And I'm going to be signing off. Feel free to chat amongst yourselves. And I know that the department was really happy to see you back, and we're hoping to be able to have you back in person someday as well.
All right, great. Thanks so much for having me.
All right, take care.
Thanks, okay. Tina. That was great. Thanks.
Thank you so much. Yeah, I'm happy to stay if you wanted to talk.
Great. Great to see you, Tina. That's a wonderful talk and just gave so much for all of us to think about and how we approach pain. Thank you so much.
Oh, yeah, you're welcome. Hi, Dr. Evers. How are you?
Welcome back, Tina. Great to see you.
Yeah, great to see you too. So to answer your question regarding sex differences in pain outcomes and underlying biology, sex-specific treatment approaches, and how do you develop them thoughtfully, happy to, yeah. So, I think that is a really important component to applying precision pain medicine. So that's one of my areas of interest in research, not just, you know, sex differences, gender differences, and pain treatment outcomes, but what are the different factors that influence how people respond to pain treatment, and how do we figure out what the best possible treatment is for each individual patient? And sex could be one of those things. I did a lot of work with Steve Cohen looking at various, quote, biomarkers, like behavioral biomarkers or other demographic and clinical characteristics. And I think that would be something like when we make a risk profile for like a patient with OSA or something like that, like it's very natural to just include sex as part of the scoring criteria. It's as a biological variable, and that's how we would apply it into these algorithms to treat patients.
Yeah, I just thought about it as a component of personalized medicine, but I also thought about repercussions in terms of whether there might be resistance on the patient side for in maybe pharmacologic interventions that are more directed based on their sex, and how would you navigate that?
Yeah, and I think it depends on how you present it to the patient and where it's coming from. It's not coming from a place of discrimination and saying like, oh, you are less worthy, so we're giving you a different treatment, or oh, you know, because you're female, we're giving you something that's going to work less effectively. We take it from a perspective of, well, here's the data. We know that in women, this treatment works a lot better. And because we want to give you the best possible care, we're going to suggest this. It doesn't mean that you can't have the other treatments, but we think that this is the best treatment for you right now. And it's just, I mean, it's the same way that when I try to like offer things like cognitive behavioral therapy for patients who have chronic pain, they want me to tell them I can do a procedure or give them a pill. But I tell them, you know, based on what you're telling me, based on what you have going on, and based on what you've responded to so far, like taking all that data together, I'm going to tell you that cognitive behavioral therapy is going to offer you the most likely, the greatest likelihood of success. And I think if you look at it from that way, like, okay, you're really trying to help this patient. It's not that you're trying to marginalize them. I think patients are a lot more accepting of that.
That's wonderful. Thanks so much, Tina. Great to see you.
Great.
Hi, Tina. Good to see a resident back again.
Yeah.
So if I could follow up on Ben's query, does there exist an intervention, drug, or something right now for which we would actually say, because you are female, biologically or male or whatever, that this is the preferred intervention?
No.
Okay. Because you had addressed it in a hypothetical idea. I couldn't think of anything which would possibly fit that paradigm.
And part of that has to do with the current state of pain research, right? We and that was what I was talking about. We haven't really studied those differences in a thoughtful way.
I'd ask the question because Jim Eisenach just came and presented yesterday, and he has a study ongoing on oxytocin, and I started thinking about differences of oxytocin levels of males and females, and whether at some point there might be certain endocrine interventions that might be more boosted towards women versus men. That was where my thought was coming from,
yeah.
John.
Yeah.
Right. Well, thank you.
All right. Well, thank you. Great to see everyone. I hope you guys all enjoy the rest of your day.